Thanks, Kathy, and thanks everyone for coming. Excuse me if I'm a bit tired today. It's been a long run of days, but I'm looking forward to getting into this. So I come up here a lot, and I've come up here a lot over the years since about the year 2000 doing frog work. And I've done a lot, quite a few talks and frog ID workshops and things, but the one thing I've never talked about is the evolutionary history of the Coranda tree frog, Latoria myola, and some of the ecological things. So I've always talked more about conservation and all those kind of things, whereas the story behind this is actually a super interesting story scientifically, and I'll tell you the story of that today. It was a big deal at the time. So we published this work in Nature, which is probably arguably the highest journal in the world. And this story that you see today gets taught at UC Berkeley and other places. It's become a bit of a thing in evolutionary biology. So you should be proud that there's like an international evolutionary biology system happening right here on your doorsteps. It's an example of evolution in action and that kind of thing. So it's about these frogs, the two frogs. They're both called green-eyed tree frogs. One's the Coranda tree frog and the other one's the normal green-eyed tree frog. I'll introduce myself first, if we go to the next slide. So currently I'm at James Cook University down in Townsville, and my history is that I did a Bachelor of Science at University of Queensland. I then did an honours degree up here on evolutionary history of microhylid frogs, these frogs across the mountaintops that have now come under attention for climate change impacts. Then I went to, I stayed at UQ, and I went away for a while. Then I came back to UQ and did a PhD on this stuff that I'll tell you today. And then I got funded by the government for 4 years to do research at ANU, so I went to Canberra. Then I got another four-year contract, a fellowship from the government, and I brought that to JCU, and then I got employed at JCU as an ongoing researcher lecturer. So the next slide, please. My work, I always describe it as falling into two things. It's all about diversity. That's what I've cared about since I was a little kid. All I cared about at home was like all the birds we had in the yard and all that stuff. I was always bugging mum for like the latest bird book for my birthday, and even when I was 10 and that sort of thing. So I'm interested in what's out there. So diversity, how we go about finding it. So I found a whole lot of species like up on Cape York and places like that and described them. I'm interested in how species form genetically all the way through and how they continue to adapt to change. How we can species could truly adapt to climate change and other things like that. And I'm interested in every form of conservation. So what's the future of species like Latoria myola? We've got projects on quolls at the moment, all sorts of different things. How can we go about accepting that there's going to be some amount of development? Things change. What can we do to try keep as much wildlife functioning in as good a way as possible through time? Thank you. Okay, so today we'll focus in on one system, and I'll start broadly, and that's by talking about rainforest in Australia. Rainforest has a declining history in Australia, so tens of millions of years ago, even this stuff out here was rainforest. Hence, you've heard about Riversleigh. Those fossil deposits are largely rainforest deposits. So over time, as Australia has drifted north and dried out, it's found itself in a drier and drier climate, and rainforest is contracted to the coast. In most areas, we would have just flat out lost rainforest altogether if it wasn't for mountain ranges. So when you look at Google Earth now and you see all those dark green strips down the east coast, pretty much that's almost showing you topography. So the reason we need mountains is that most of the rainfall through a lot of the year, if you exclude the monsoonal period in the north, is that coming from those southeast trade winds, that moisture-laden air that's coming off the coast, hitting the mountains, rising up and forming mist and rain. So when we look at the wet tropics, it's all about mountains and rainforest. And you get it in the lowlands too, because you get the rain coming down on that eastern side. As soon as you go over the mountains, that's super rapid rain shadowing effect. You see that here. I think the statistic is that Coranda has twice the amount of rain per annum as like oak forest or something. You see that really rapid drop off. So we have some major areas. We've got the Cape York rainforest. Cape Melville's come under attention through some explorations I've done there. And then we've got the wet tropics. Mid-East Queensland, the Yungala area you've probably heard about behind Mackay. These areas are all pretty discrete. So through time, rainforest is contracted to those mountains. It sat there for tens of millions of years, kind of marooned in an area like the wet tropics with dry barriers to the north and south. So it's built up all this unique diversity that it's kind of hung on to through time. And it's not just, you often hear the wet tropics called an ancient kind of arc and all this stuff. It has had that effect. It's kind of captured all this diversity that was once more widespread. But that sort of overlooks the fact that, of course, evolution continues, diversification continues, so it's still an active place of diversification. So we'll focus in just on the sweat tropics. I think that's the next slide. Oh yeah, so I said that. You know where you are sitting in Karanda. Next slide, please. So the wet tropics is far and away the most important area of rainforest in Australia. It ranks super high in the world on one really key environmental value, and that's endemism. So when you hear someone say a species is endemic to Australia or something, it just means it's only found in the area you're specifying. So we've got a lot of creatures, including many, many vertebrates, that are endemic, i.e. found only in the wet tropics rainforest. Chowchillas, Victoria's rifle bird, the list goes on, the mulch tree kangaroo, all these things. And that endemism could either be like all through the wet tropics, or you get species that are only on top of Benlin and Kerr and Bartlefreyer or something like that. So the diversity of the wet tropics worldwide, if you compare it to other rainforests, the sheer diversity isn't particularly high. It's pretty good, but it's not very high. It doesn't really compare to New Guinea or Borneo or somewhere. What's super important in the wet tropics is how unique that wildlife is. It's old lineages, new lineages, all these things, and they're only found in the wet tropics. The Burdekin Gap to the south and the Laura Gap to the north has held them in isolation for so long that they're just unique. So the one we'll talk about today, we'll start talking about before we eventually work the story towards Myola, is this tree frog, the green-eyed tree frog. That frog is found everywhere from down by Crystal Creek at Paluma all the way up to Big Tablelands near Cooktown. Everything that's dark green on that map, that's rainforest, you'll find this frog, and it's really, really common. Okay? It lives on streams. When you hear people talk about a stream frog, it's usually a bit of a... It tricks you into thinking they just live on streams. Males live on streams, they call on streams, and they breed on streams. But the females and the subadults and things, they're off in the forest. So the forest we see out here will have green-eyed tree frogs even hundreds of meters away from the streams. They just live all through the forest. But the place you typically find them is the streams. Here's a Perinam plexus, little male and a big female. Females are about five times the weight of males. So if you imagine that in human terms, it'd be quite spectacular. And males call a lot. They wrestle a lot. It's all very interactive. They lay their eggs in the stream. About 2 months later, little frogs vanish off into the forest and you don't see them again until they're adults. I'll come back to ecology later. Okay, so the first thing was, this creature is common all through the wet tropics, all the way through. If you did genetics on it, you'd think that they should all be pretty much the same, right? Like there's just gene flow all through them. There's not really any major breaks through the wet tropics now. It's fairly continuous. If you put frog dots on maps for the Serrata, they're all through the wet tropics. So what we did, what I did early in the piece was go throughout the wet tropics, and I took a little genetic sample from hundreds of frogs throughout the range. We've gone to the days where you have to kill an animal to get a genetic sample. Humans now, you know, you can just swab the inside of your cheek. On a frog, I pick it up and I can just nick a little bit of toe pad. It doesn't even bleed. It's this minute little piece. It's almost like if you nicked your finger on something but it doesn't bleed. You know, you see a little bit of the skin stick up. It's equivalent of that. And what I did across those hundreds of individuals, for every individual, I pulled out a piece of the mitochondrial genome called cytochrome layers 1. It has some function in energy production. 550 base pairs. So base pairs just means A, C, G, T, 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 G, 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 all the way out to 550. And then I lined those 550 base pairs up across hundreds of individuals. And of course, they're all going to be different in different ways. Mum and dad and the kids are going to be quite similar across that piece. Someone at the north and the south of the wet tropics, you might expect to be a bit different. But with lots of gene flow, you might expect a similar tree, like really not much structuring. So next slide. What we got though was mind-blowing. The north lineage, so all that blue from Big Tableland down to Karanda and Lamb Range is a northern lineage, and the rest down to Paluma is a southern lineage. That CO1 divergence there, 13%, so 13% of the base, those 550 base pairs differ on average between north and south. That's a bit like, that equates, if you use the molecular clock, which is a bit approximate, to about 4 or so million years of isolation. It's almost like the CO1 difference between us and chimpanzees. So it's a whopping divergence. Something's gone on in the history of this frog that you don't even get a look at when you see it today, because you can pick up a frog in the south or the north, they look kind of the same in your hand. What we did then, and this was at a time when we were sequencing lots of different species across the wet tropics, we found this pattern. The green-eyed tree frog is the most spectacular, but in anything that was a rainforest-restricted creature that doesn't get around easily. So insect that can't fly found in the forest, lizards in the rainforest, that kind of thing. As you get out to things like fruit pigeons and other birds, you don't see it very much, so they've had more connectivity. That still doesn't answer the question though, but we now know the answer if you go to the next slide. So it's continuous now, but we know that rainforest hasn't done this all the time. So we as humans, we tend to look at the world as if it's always going to be like this, but it doesn't. It's never like this. It's going to change. It changed in the past. And we know that in the glacial cycles, as you go back, we know there were really dry, intense periods when, for example, 18,000 years ago was the last glacial maxima. So much of the world's moisture was locked into north and south polar ice caps. The world was just a drier place. Even the Amazon shrunk back into refuges. And we know from the wet tropics, this yellow and red is an approximation of suitability for rainforest under current conditions. That would pretty much look like the dark green we saw before. When you model back in time, you see that you can use a variety of modeling ways. This is ultimately also based on, so when you sink pollen cores in some areas, you can actually look at that change through time. So if you sunk a pollen core in Coranda, it'd go rainforest to the present, then dry forest, then rainforest. You can see because it changes to eucalyptus pollen, casuarina pollen, stuff like that. We know even on the tablelands and places like that, there's been areas that have just gone rainforest, dry forest. Also fossil charcoal, rainforest doesn't burn, but the same areas that have the pollen change, you see charcoal in there. So we know that 18,000 years ago and at many times previous to that, back to millions of years, there's been periods when the wet tropics has not looked like it did today. So 18,000 years ago, this area around Coranda probably looked more like Coa. So it would have been a drier forest, a bit of riparian scrub, maybe a bit more like Davies Creek even. If you just go back a sec, there's two areas, this central area stayed rainforest, for example, Bartle Frere through all time, southern tablelands, and like Mount Lewis and Thornton Peak, those kind of places have probably stayed true rainforest through all time. And that's why you see those really ancient plant families at Thornton Peak and you don't see them in other areas. It's why southern tablelands and carbine tableland have the highest diversity. It's persistent through time. Anyway, so that explains that north-south, but 18,000 years ago doesn't. That wouldn't be enough time. But if that happened again and again through the past, then it does explain it. Why do you get those genetic differences? It's what happens is that on every single base pair all the time, there's a random chance of mutation. If you just ramp that out through time, you just accumulate random change. So this isn't a result of selection or anything. It's just random change if you give it enough time. Okay, so the important thing for this story is that there's a north and a south lineage, but they're now in contact. So if we go, that north-south lineage would have contracted here, north lineage up in here. Since the rainforest has re-expanded, it's brought these guys back together in this area. So next one. So the really cool thing with contact zones is that they allow us to actually look at evolution in action, because all these different species that have these lineages have a different amount of genetic divergence, or some might have changed a bit in mating call or bird color or something like that. When they come back together, you can actually look at what's happening directly in nature where two divergent lineages come back together. So I do a lot of work studying hybridization, and that's what this is all about. Another thing that supports the idea that there was a southern and a northern refuge is that the contact point between, in many species, is in this area, somewhere between Coranda and Lamb Range. All these different species that have north and south lineages, they're now back in contact. So prickly skinks are just up on Black Mountain Road, that's their contact. Leaf-tailed geckos are just up on Black Mountain Road. Little microhylid frogs are to the south of us. We know where all their contacts are. Yep. Litoria riocola, that contact zone's on Streets Creek. You drive over it when you come up towards Rainforest Station. So we're going to focus in on that, and we're going to focus on just one of those species, the green-eyed tree frog. So next one. So this is what you expect. You expect all that southern lineage to meet all that northern lineage somewhere in the wet tropics, and that's the contact. The one you don't expect, which made this system so fascinating, is that for some reason, which I'll come back to at the end of the talk, there's a little population of the southern lineage within the northern lineage area. Somehow it got trapped in that area amongst all those northern frogs, and that's here. So Coranda, Fairyland, Myola, Carola, out to Oak Forest. That's this population that got trapped. I have a theory on that happened, and we'll come back to that. But what it sets up is a really cool system where it's not just two lineages meeting, it's this mosaic where you get this weird isolated population. Okay, so this is now just showing the same thing, but with more genetics. At every one of these sites, there's 20 individuals have been done for genetics. This doesn't mean they're hybrids, it just means both co-occur. And you can see there's that isolated southern population up around Coranda. If we scoot back one, other thing to point out too is that that population, the population hasn't been isolated for a long time. Genetically, it sits within the rest of the southern lineage. So we know it's happened quite recently, whatever's going on there. Next. And another. Okay, so cool things happen when lineages meet. It all depends on how different they are. They could just meet, and then they could have lots of gene flow, and with time, they just become genetically similar, and they just merge back into each other. That's that second one. First one is maybe they can't hybridize. They could be so different. They're like a donkey and a horse producing a mule, something sterile or worse. You could form a hybrid species. That happens a bit in plants. What happens there is they mate, but instead of the usual meiosis stage, the chromosomes just get both. So they become twice the number of chromosomes they should have. These polyploid plants are common. The other one is that you could form a stable clone where it's bad to hybridize, but there's so much gene flow coming in, it just sits as a hybrid zone. Or the last one, which is this system, they could speciate through reinforcement. And I won't go into a lot of detail on this, but what that means is that when they meet, if it's bad to hybridize, you don't want to hybridize. There should be selection against that. So if you're hybridizing and you're leaving no offspring, you're contributing way less alleles and genes to the next generation than those around you that can choose their own lineage. So there should be choice for like females to choose the call that's most different, that kind of thing, because anything that's genetic to do with that gets passed on. A female that chooses the most different call of the IS guys will leave offspring because she doesn't make the mating mistake with the Northerns. If you mate with the Northerns, etc. I'll show you that now. Yep. First thing I wanted to know was they're so divergent, I doubted they could even interbreed. So I did these crosses in the lab. This is actually quite a natural thing. It's happening every night on these hybrid zones. North and South are together, for example, on Cloessy River and Lamb Range. Every night, I can tell you from genetics, I know there's mating mistakes happening out there. Wrong male with wrong female, that kind of thing. So I wanted to establish with a handful of crosses how bad it is to do that. The results were super interesting. So if you take any northern female, and if she mates with a southern male, I call it okay, but I now know it's not okay, but it's better than the opposite. So in the lab, they'll grow through to metamorphose, but about 1 in 10 or 20 are missing an eye, and it looks like almost none of them survive. And we know now from genetics, where this is naturally happening, like on Cloessy River, almost none of these are making it, if any, are making it through to adulthood. It's just funky. It's like a mule kind of situation. The reverse is definitely not on. So if you, a southern female mates with any northern male, there's good fertilization success, the eggs hatch out, but at about 7 or 8 days, they all die. You can put money on it. You can know that tomorrow when you walk in, those tadpoles would have died. So when they go from resorbing their yolk to using their mouth parts, there's a genetic trigger that's just stuffed up by crossing those genetics. The fact that it's asymmetric tells us what the mechanism is, even though we don't know the detail. The mechanism is that because the mitochondrial DNA is maternally inherited, just like humans, it's a problem between something that's happening on the mitochondrial DNA and something that's happening on the nuclear DNA. That's why it's asymmetric depending on the sex involved. Okay, so it's asymmetric. The key thing for this talk is to realize there should be intense selection against hybridizing in those hybrid zones. You don't want to do it. You'll leave basically no offspring. Yep. So it's a dead end. It's pretty much a dead end in the other direction. We know that that huge split has pretty much led to speciation, but there's a more complicated story coming up. And there should be very strong selection for getting your right mates right. And I've explained that before. This is the idea of reinforcement, where mating traits and choice for those traits, like the male call difference and the choice for those call differences, should be better in the hybrid zone than it should be away from the hybrid zone. Okay, so firstly I thought, well, let's just see if these things really do look and sound exactly the same. Wandering around in the wet tropics, it kind of looked that way. Firstly, I thought, well, let's measure lots of frogs. Let's see if they look like they're doing something different in the environment ecologically, because that might show up in body size or shape. And let's look at the calls to see whether there looks like there'll be mating isolation based on calls, because everything to do with mating in frogs is based on call. Males will mate with anything. They'll mate with the wrong species if you let them. Females, though, are hyper choosy. Females only want one particular male. Males are just, well, anything. So next one. See, well, it doesn't matter to them because their optimal strategy is to mate with anything and everything, because all they have to do is produce a little twinkly bit of sperm. They can mate again in 2 nights' time if they want. A female, she's come all the way out of the forest. She's only going to breed once that year. That's her entire reproductive output for a whole year, which might be 30% of her life. She wants to make sure she does a good job of it. Okay, so I measured lots, I think 1,000 plus. Keep going down. Various things to get an idea of size and shape. And next one down. What I found was that there's a lot of these plots, so I'll explain them now. There's something on that I measured on the Y, and some the lineages on the X, the North, the IS, and the Southern. The North and the South lineages are morphologically indistinguishable. It's exactly what I thought in the hand. You can't pick them. Someone could hand me, after seeing 1,000, someone can still hand me one of each, and I can't tell you which one's which. The really cool, interesting thing, though, was that the this little isolated Southern population in here, the males are really small, tiny little things. So something's driven a smaller body size just in them. Okay, next one. Then I measured lots of calls. Calls are hard on these guys because they're really aware of their surroundings. And as soon as you roll up, they're just kind of like watching you and they're like, I'm not going to call. So I had to like set up, there's a little frog here, set up the microphone, and then I had a 10 meter lead and I'd go hide in the bushes and just sit there because then he'd forget about me and start calling again. Eventually I got lots of calls. I measured various things because I wanted to look at it much like a female frog would look at it, not just one trait, but a combined effect of what the sound sounds like. So like a multivariate thing where I put it all together. Next one. The really interesting thing is that there is a difference between the North and the South call. So frogs calling side by side here, they do on average have a bit of a different call. There is of course overlap. You can see that overlap in this zone here. But there is a difference. The really cool thing though is that this call up here is well different to both. Tiny bit of overlap with the South, but it's different on all those different characteristics. So, and I already knew that. I was already, as I was finding frogs here and doing that little genetic scrape, I was writing them in my notebook as whether I thought they were one or the other, because I can hear the call differences. And I'm 100% right on those. Like, you can hear it. It's a really fast call. So, actually, I'll describe the calls. This one kind of goes like, the other one goes, the Southerns go a bit quicker. The Myolas, the ISs, go really high pitch, short, fast. Doesn't sound like any difference when I just do it like that, but believe me, when you get your ear in, you can hear it. And you'd think a female frog can hear it even better than I can, right? Like that's what they do. Next one down. The question though is that what do females make of these call differences? So what I did was I gave the females an alien encounter where I'd find a female that's come down to the stream chock full of eggs looking to choose a male. I'd carefully put her in a bag with some vegetation, and then I had nearby set up an enclosure where there was two, one of the average calls for this group and one of the calls for this group, for example, playing. And she couldn't see any speakers, it was just shade cloth. And then she had 5 minutes to listen, and then she had to choose a call by climbing up to within 20 centimeters of the speakers. And it was remarkable. They're like little robots. When they've come down pumped full of hormones and they really want to breed that night, you give them a call and they'll make a choice every time. So the females would climb up and they'd circle around just on the shade cloth going, man, where is he? And it was all under infrared light. And they just looked like Gollum looking around. So, and then within an hour or so, they were back on the stream wondering what was all that about? It would be pretty weird. They're temporarily abducted. I did that. What they would think here, what they would think here, and the non-biological situation of what happens if an IS and an S kind of ended up in the same area. So next one down, please. This one looks a bit complicated at first, but it's not. This is contact A down here, where this is what happens when a northern female is choosing. Northern females generally got it wrong, chose more southern calls than they got, and then, you know, there's no choice there, basically. A southern female here as well, she chose more southerns, but there's no significant choice here. It looks like females are a bit like me. They can't really choose the right calls at that contact zone. They just don't really hear the difference. I now know that's the case because in the last couple of years, I've gone up and down those hybrid zones and done the genetics of males and females together where they've actually chosen it and are in amplexus, and they've got it wrong as much as they've got it right. So they're just making mating mistakes all the time there. The situation here for this comparison, what happens when females are listening to calls here, is much cleaner. So IS females, the females there, they always get it right. They always get it right. And they do it quickly. They're really determined to get the right call. The northern females, the Serrata northern females around here, they generally get it right about 70% of the time, but they occasionally get it wrong. But either way, the choice, oh yeah, you can go to the next one, is actually a good one. That up here, choice is very strong. Down here, there's almost no assortative mating. They're just making mistakes. So the other one, the really interesting one as well, I thought is, let's try males and females from calls and female choice from here and here, just within that southern lineage. And that they always get it right as well. So to our looking at that analysis, those two calls, they actually look a bit more similar, the IS and the southern call. But to females, they're really different. They never make a mistake on that. They always choose the right call. So although they don't ever have that opportunity in the wild, you never know, maybe one day they would if rainforest changes or something. Okay, so that's what I just explained. Really good choice here, poor choice here, and good choice between the two red southern areas. Okay, so what all this added up to in a very abbreviated way is that if you do another click, we know that there's really strong selection against mating mistakes here. It's as bad at both contacts. It doesn't matter which one you're at, that fundamental underlying genetic difference will mean that it's a dead end in one direction and it's essentially near, basically a dead end in the other. What's happened at this hybrid zone up here, if you click one more, is that what reinforcement has happened there. So the males of those ISs would have, so this situation would have been pretty much like this. Sorry, that would have been like this when it first started. There would have been that slight southern and northern call difference. And that's been amplified through time. It's been reinforced. So the more females that chose the more divergent call, there was sexual selection on that, and the calls have done this at that contact. And they've speciated. They don't want anything to do with each other, even though they occur side by side. You should say, like, why hasn't that happened here? The problem here that we've worked out is that all these frogs here in the IS population are under selection. Everyone's involved in this potential mating mistake situation. At basically every IS site, every Myola site, there's also Serratas. Down here, it's just like a 500 meter wide section in an otherwise huge distributions. So no matter how much selection you apply in here, no matter how wrong it is, you always have this naive gene flow coming in, these genes that just completely dilute any evolution of choice or anything in here. And we know from like classic evolutionary biology stuff that it's near impossible to select on something if there's a lot of gene flow coming in. It just is always going to dilute it out. So reinforcement has happened here, it hasn't happened here. Ultimately though, these guys barely interbreed. I suspect they don't interbreed at all because there's that genetic problem underneath it all. Next one down. So there's a big difference. So what happened out of the back of this, taxonomically, is that based on that, I kept the north and the south lineages as one species, still Latoria serrata, just acknowledging there's a whopping divergence. Based on my latest, all the genetic data since this point, these things, I can sort of give you a heads up that ultimately I will be describing splitting them. You can't keep two things together that just can't reproduce. Like we've, in hundreds of individuals on those hybrid zones in Lamb Range, we've only found one individual out of hundreds that's a first generation hybrid, even though they're occurring side by side, 50-50, and making lots and lots of mating mistakes. It's just not, doesn't work. This little guy, this isolated southern population that sort of disappeared with like the small scale, that's the one I described as Latoria myola. Although it sits genetically within the southern lineage, it's reproductively isolated. It can't breed with the northerns anyway because of that genetic problem. And even if it came in contact with this, with the rest of the southern lineage, you'd reasonably believe, based on, for example, those lab choice trials, that they just wouldn't choose each other. Don't even seem to recognize each other's calls. So these ones sit as a reproductively isolated thing. And if we skip to the next slide, when you hear the term species, people are usually using this term, this definition called the biological species concept. And that means there's complete or near complete reproductive isolation. So two things are considered two different species if they pretty much can't interbreed and produce viable offspring. And Myola fits that. Okay, but it would be overlooked if you just did a genetic screening or something because it's sort of just sitting within that southern lineage. Yes, ultimately the evidence is stacking up, particularly the genetics, that we probably shouldn't consider Serrata as one species. So the question of quite a pretty of interest is, how old is Myola as a species? We always get told about species being something really old, like it happened millions of years ago, or tens of thousands, or hundreds of thousands of years ago. Latoria myola almost certainly evolved into a distinct species in the last 10,000 years. When rainforest, so remember I said 18,000 years ago, there probably was no rainforest around here. Everything was held north and south. It reconnected about 7,000 years ago, that's the best estimates. And then that evolutionary process kicked in, where it started diverging and diverging and verging. And so we have one of the most recently documented speciation events anywhere. And genetically, yeah, there's just no way it's older than about 10,000 years. So it's a recent species. A really cool question too is, how on earth did this this situation arise? It's so weird that there would be this, you don't see it in other species around here. You just see like a north and a south contact. The thing that's really interesting to note too is that the myola palm, you might have heard about this, Psychontophoenix myolensis, it's down on Worrell Creek and Owen and a few other places. It has a distribution that's remarkably similar to Latoria myola. It's at most of the myola sites, it's at some of the myola sites, it's not at all of them. It's probably not as well surveyed as the frog. Basically, you have a palm and a frog that have a very similar distribution. What I think's happened here is that if we go one more down, I think, Coranda looks like this now. It's kind of like this narrow neck of the wet tropics where it's rainforest. 18,000 years ago, as I said, it would have looked like koa or something like that, something really dry. So if we skip the next slide down. But in a landscape like that, this is that koa area. Here's Davies Creek and Cloessie Meeting going into the Barren. If you go to an area like that, you do see some decent riparian. So something as big as the Barren would have had riparian vegetation on it. If it had hung on to enough of that riparian vegetation, such as in that big slow bends of the Barren before it gets to the Barren Falls through Myola and that, that probably was quite a big, slow, boggy, muddy kind of bend. The frogs could have hung on there and the palms could have hung on there. So while everyone else disappeared to the north and south, they were left marooned there. And then re-expansion is complex. Who's to say that southerns are going to come back into that area before northerns? So I think that the palms and these frogs got marooned in this area, and then the northerns happened to spread back into that area and come around them. So it could be that. I'm not saying it is, but it seems like a likely scenario. Yeah, so you end up with that re-expansion. Okay, so that's probably how that IS population ended up here and then became Myola. Next one, please. Okay, so how do these frogs live? That's something that might be of real interest to you, interest to you if you live around here. The males are small. They live around the streams. When it's cold, like June, July, August, they probably go off into the forest as well. The females are much larger. They live up in the treetops, right up the canopy, away from the stream. I've seen them over 100 meters away from streams. They're much bigger. They come to the streams probably only once a year to choose a male and lay their eggs. The males probably, the eggs metamorphose out, the males come back. They probably come back when they're about 1 year old. The females probably don't turn up until they're 2 years old. So the frogs are more long-lived than I think most people realise. These individuals could live a long time, but everything likes eating frogs. So you'd probably put the average age of a Latoria myola out there at about 5 years or something. Some studies have shown that if you look at some, you know, rainforest frog ages, they're anywhere from about, you know, 3 years to 15 years. If you look after a green tree frog in captivity, you can keep that thing alive for like 30 years. They're really long-lived animals. They just die in the end. Something eats them, a snake or something. This is a kind of classic Latoria myola stream, but it's very variable. So some sites around here, they don't even flow all year. They get, say, 4 months of flow after the wet season, and that's still good. It's enough time for everything to go through. Then you get these medium-sized streams, and then you get all the way up to Jumrum Creek and Worrell Creek, big permanent streams. They flow all year. The female's up in the canopy, the little male will be sitting on a palm frond or something. She kind of hangs out back in the forest, decides who she wants, comes forward, mates. They drop into the water, and then they'll choose like a riffle area like this. And they'll put a sticky clump behind a rock in the flowing water. And it's like a jelly clump, and they wedge it in, and within like half an hour it's covered in sediments, and you wouldn't even know it's there. Why do you think they would put it in these little shallow areas? Doesn't anyone know why? Lots of stream frogs use these little shallow bits for the eggs. Yeah, it's probably a bit more oxygenated. Any other reasons? Yeah, predation. Yeah, like rainforest frogs do everything they can to avoid putting eggs in the pools, because you can imagine putting a pile of frogs' eggs in a pool. Purple-spotted gudgeons and rainbow fish and things would just hammer them. So the eggs live in here. They, some other frogs in the wet tropics, like the mottled barred frogs, you might hear them at your place. They make that like, oh, that really deep noise. They flick their eggs up on the wet banks. And after a week, the little tadpoles flick out of the eggs and wiggle their way down into the stream. Yeah, so down south, we also have gastric brooding frogs that, they're extinct now, unfortunately, but they used to swallow their eggs and rear the young within the stomach and then basically throw up the babies after a couple of months. They're all evolutionary strategies to avoid dealing with fish in streams, primarily, probably other reasons. Sorry, if you go back one more sec, Sylvia. There's so they, about a week in this stuff, and then about 6 weeks in a pool, the tadpoles will just make their way into a pool, sit there eating detritus, leaf litter and that on the bottom. Then they'll metamorphose out. I never ever see a young frog. I don't know where they go. It's like turtles disappearing out. They might go with the turtles out into the Pacific or something, as far as I'm aware. They just vanish. I suspect they go right up into the canopy. So you only see adults. And this is what the tadpole looks like. Always a bar on the back. Hasn't got a super shiny mirror belly, which the Stony Creek frogs have. So anyway, after a couple of months, tad's out and they're off in the forest. Next one, please. So it's critically endangered or endangered, depending on which scheme you look at, whether it's international IUCN or federal EPBC or state NCA. Why has it got such a high listing? It's because it's got this tiny distribution, very, very small, between Jumrum Creek and Coranda and around through Myola out to Janetta Creek out by, I guess you'd call that the Oak Forest Way. That distribution is also fragmented across a bunch of each particular breeding site. There's about 13 breeding sites. They're all really small. They're typically within about 500 metres or less of the Barron River. So it's these tiny little breeding populations, and altogether it's not many adults. It goes up and down over long periods depending on wet seasons and that, but you'd always estimate it as less than 1,000. The big threats are those. I'm sure you can all imagine those threats. The thing with these frogs is that there's two things you need to consider. You need to consider the stream, and you need to consider the forest around. So without the forest around, you might have good breeding areas in a little narrow riparian strip, but they just won't be there. The females can't live in, they don't live on the stream. So without the forest around, maybe 100 meter buffer, that kind of thing, you won't have the frogs there. So that's an issue. That's a big issue. So the problem for this species is, well, there's two key problems in this area. Almost none of their distribution is protected formally. There's some in Jumrum Creek Conservation Park, but most of it's on private land or council land, that kind of thing. Luckily, it's a green community, so that does help. The problem, though, is that you have a breeding site. They're always at the bottom of the streams, so they're just susceptible to anything that happens in the catchment. The catchment of a stream is huge. You clear a massive area, so much sediment can come down and stuff up a breeding site. So they've got this crazy situation where the threat is not just the site, it's a huge area above them. That's a really bad one. That photo I showed you before, you would have seen riffles are typically only that deep in where these guys breed. If you send a whole lot of sediment down like this, if there's a development and there's lots of sediment, once you get like this much sediment, the water's just sitting in the sediment. There's for years that frogs can have no access to it. We don't, like, you want to keep flow regimes about the same and water quality. Who knows where exactly the limits lie for tadpoles, but you'd want it to be as natural as possible. You might have heard of chytrid fungus disease that decimated frogs the world over, particularly in the tropics. We lost several species in the wet tropics. They went flat out extinct around 1991 and 1992. These guys, I think that most Latoria myola and most frogs living around water in Coranda will have chytrid on them. It's just that in these hot environments we have around here, chytrid doesn't do well above about 18 degrees. So 18 is about optimal for chytrid, 16 to 18. Once you get into the 20 degrees, it'll survive, but it doesn't really proliferate on the frog skin. So in warmer environments like the lowlands and places like Coranda, the frogs can survive with chytrid on them. In the mountaintops where it's cold, they die. So a lot of frogs in the wet tropics lost all the populations above 500 meters, and the lowland populations have done all right. Some species like the lacelids, they declined out of the Coranda area, but they're now recolonising. So the Coranda EnviroCare Frog Monitoring Project has now started picking up lacelids at some of the sites, which is super exciting. They're coming back into the area, which is great. hybridization, obviously that's a funny one to put as a threat, given I've just given you a whole talk about hybridization creating the species. The thing is, hybridization, things can get pretty funky in a disturbed landscape. If you get down to 1 or 2 myolas and a 5 serratus or something, you just sort of like really muck up what females have to choose from, and they might often, you see more hybridization in disturbed landscapes just because you run out of choice. Things are just not natural anymore. It's probably not a major issue. These guys have really diverged enough that it's probably not an issue. And I think there might be a, yeah, so here's an example. What's that road that goes to Russet Park there? Sorry? Yeah, Karagi there, yeah. This was years ago, maybe more than a decade ago, there was a dam put on this creek. Obvious impact, clearing the rainforest. The bigger impact though, long-term, was this dam wall that was sort of dodgy brothers. The next wet season, it just eroded away, and there was a good myola population below that. That myola population was gone for years after that. I'm not even sure. They are further down on that stream. I haven't had a chance to go back through here, but that sediment just became this thick in the creek. No matter how big your wet seasons are, you're only going to keep shifting a bit of that. And the problem is, you've got the constant contribution from this on and on. So sedimentation is a huge issue. The other thing is, it also makes things a bit unnatural because toads won't breed in streams. They very rarely will breed in a stream. They avoid flowing water. Whereas this is like toad nirvana. They're just like, they're every night breeding in huge numbers. I don't know what the interaction is with Karanda tree frogs, but I don't want toads around them. Next slide. So currently, we've got a project that we're just finishing up where we took 40,000 markers from across the genome, and we're using that to look at those same little samples I had. We're looking at all the Karanda tree frog populations, and because we have so much genetics, we can actually determine who's mum and dad, who's gone from one creek to the next. We're learning heaps about connectivity. So we're already starting to understand that a lot of those sites up along the Barron River, they're actually quite connected, more so than I ever thought they were. It's probably females, because females are off in the forest. They don't necessarily go back and breed at the stream they came from. They might just wander through their days and then hear myolas and breed there. So this genomic population connectivity one's turning out to be interesting. It's also showing that Jumrum Creek is really its own unit. There's very little mixing between here and there. Then I've got, there's a long-term monitoring project that's being led by EnviroCare with Kathy and Sylvia particularly, and the community. So if you want to be involved in that, talk to one of those two, because EnviroCare is running a project long-term over years where people go down to their local creek. It doesn't take long. You do it once every month or 2 months, 1 month. It takes about 15, 20 minutes and you record the frogs you hear. And the great thing about long-term monitoring is through time, you'll see changes. Like frogs are pretty bad because they do go up and down a lot with the years, just naturally. So to understand whether frogs are really declining or improving or whatever, you need like 5 years of data, that kind of thing. So this long-term monitoring project is nearly at its fourth year. It's great. And now we're at the point where we can start seeing trends through time. And it's through this monitoring that, for example, that we picked up that lace lids are coming back. So this has been some pretty cool results. Also, I have to give a shout out to Karanda EnviroCare's work along the river too, because all that replanting is directly helping the frogs. You'll notice that if you look down on Google Earth onto this area from Google Earth, you see that nice sort of strip that's just getting better and better and better as all the Barron River plantings are growing up. So that's a fantastic thing for these frogs and for everything else that lives out there. And I think that might just about be it. Yeah. If you want to read more, if that wasn't enough like nitty gritty genetic detail, visit that one. I will say that paper is 4 pages long, but the supplementary material with all the genetics in that is 35 pages or something. Yeah. With all the genetics in that is 35 pages or something. Yeah.